Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is G Cole, and welcome to Homegrown, where I get to share with you some good music while talking to some great people.
Hello, world. I hope you're feeling as good as I am. I want to go ahead and big up all my Homegrown listeners out there and welcome all the new listeners. If you haven't yet subscribed, please do so we can keep you updated when new material is available. We will be posting new episodes bi-weekly. I want to go ahead and thank everybody who always listens and shares. Please leave us a comment. We'd love to hear from you. And check out the website again, homegrownwithgcole.com, to listen for all things Homegrown. The podcast available on iTunes, Google Play, Stitcher, TuneIn, Spotify, iHeartRadio, all your podcast platforms. We're very interactive. Follow me on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook at MyGCole. We're going to be talking to the one and only Mr. Eddie Nice. I'm going to drop a joint from Eddie Nice right now, and I'll come back and talk to Eddie. Keep it moving, keep it grooving. It is Homegrown.
Woke up this morning, feel like I had to write you this letter. I wake up this world so filled with controversy. The Martin Day Marvin Gaye singing these songs of mercy. Personally, I'd rather live life than live a third degree. Where being black is being trapped with an uncertainty. I'm bleeding burgundy, building jails for the currency. Y'all ignoring the fail to see what troubles me. I keep that buzz buzzing like I'm a bumblebee. Message sent strategically more humble than I appear to be. I bet now you're not looking at me so awkwardly. Can't understand why underhand is how I masterpiece. I make music for lost souls that's hard to reach. I swear it's hard to speak calm through this inner beast. But to ignore and not explore is even more crazy. Conscious mind chase me. Thank God he paced me. They still hating lately. Appreciate it greatly. Especially for my fans texting me, you amazing. I'm in the booth teaching the youth not to be lazy. Damn it, I know the struggle had to buckle up daily. Rain, sleet, hail, snow, vision blurry. When dreams get buried and clocks move in a hurry. The most beautiful is sting word to Keith Murray. When you manage to subtract reasons your family worried. I'm hoping in July you think like January. Resolution's the solution to that commentary. Good morning, world.
Got that.
Hello, it's me again. I felt I had to talk to you, you need a friend. I'm wondering when hate became your biggest trend. It's 19 and you pretending you don't see the end. Swear a blind man can see it through his tinted lens. No pen, I typed it up and I just pressed send. Still hoping you get this message before you sleep again. Sincerely yours, your biggest friend. Morning world.
Hello.
Hello world. Good morning. Hello world. Good morning. Hello world. Good morning.
Yeah, man, that one is a dope one from Eddie Nice. Hey,
yo,
what's
yo,
good? What's
yo,
good?
Yo,
what's
yo,
good?
Yo, long time, my brother.
Too long, brother.
Yo,
too long.
Yo, you ain't saying nothing. You ain't saying nothing. But it's all love. It's all love. It's like yesterday, right?
As all, trust me, that's the thing with the good people, man.
Yeah,
you ain't seen them in years, and when you see them, it's like yesterday.
Yeah, yeah.
Love it, love it, love it, love it, love it. And like I always tell you, when it comes to hip hop, I love the real. The real.
I love the compliments. The compliments. The compliments is just.
I love the real.
I don't even know what to do with my face, man. When you do these compliments, man, I have no idea what to do with my face, man.
Dude, I love the real, and I've been sharing it with people who I know love the real too, and they're loving it.
Nice.
Brooklyn MC.
Nice.
In Florida, but the Brooklyn MC.
Nice. Nice.
You know what I feel like? I feel like the opening scene in Brown Sugar. When did you fall in love with hip hop?
Yeah,
you
know baby. Yeah. Yeah, baby.
Trust me. I'm loving it. World, we got Eddie Nice in the studio right now. I'm telling you, not just a great and a dope MC, but a great individual, man. Thank you. Talk to me about your Brooklyn MC.
No, first off, let me, before I even let you start, man.
Yeah.
Because you just gave me an intro. So, let me just say this real quick. Ladies and gentlemen, G. Cole is a phenomenal, he's a phenomenal singer. I almost said an R&B artist, but he's a phenomenal singer. I don't really get into the reggae like that. I'm more so, I like the roots better than I like the dance hall.
Right, me
and,
too.
And you got the culture roots sound, you know what I mean?
Appreciate that.
And let me just share a story. He is the first person that I ever had come over to my studio to sing a hook, and he nailed it so quickly, and I was like, what? What the hell just happened?
Yo,
right? Like, he came through, he killed it, like, that quick. I was stunned.
Appreciate
so,
that.
When I say he's a phenomenal artist, he's a phenomenal artist. I love talking to him about music and his professionalism of how he even approaches music. So that's dope. We just had a conversation before we even got on the air, and it's still the same, that same professionalism. And it's like, you have people that want to do music, and they just want to do music, but they don't want to really hone into their craft.
Right,
and
right.
And my brother, I always feel that with you.
I appreciate it.
You know what I mean? And so, you know, I do have to curse him out because we do. another song that we're supposed to do is long overdue.
It's in the hard drive?
It's still in your Dropbox.
In the Dropbox?
It's still in your Dropbox.
We're going to get
But that's on him, but we won't crucify him so much. But ladies and gentlemen, this is a dope artist. Let me just say that off rip. So I am like super happy to be here.
I appreciate it. We're just diversifying the portfolio.
Yeah.
Make sure we got something else going on. Funny. And I'm going to keep it real. In terms of going in the studio, I'm making sure it's hit. It's called the budget rehearsal situation. In terms of, you know, you pay for studio time by the hour.
Yeah.
So we always make sure that we kind of knock it, nail it. So when we go in.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I've been in many studios and people are like, yo, real quick.
Yeah.
He ain't know that. Yeah. I did that 15 times in my studio.
Right. Right,
you know what I mean, but it is what it is. I appreciate it, man.
No doubt. All right, I'm sorry, guys.
No worries.
I took over your show.
No, yo, that's what it's about.
WNIC Radio. No, I'm just kidding.
That's what it is. That's what it's really nice for it. Listen, you're here rarely, so when you come in,
all right,
the floor is yours.
All right.
So, and I appreciate the presence. There are lyricists. How I break it down, they're lyricists and they're wordsmiths.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? It's a conversation I have with people all the time. They're lyricists, they're wordsmiths. Big up yourself, Hal Anthony. Big up Kurt, everybody that's locked in right now, everybody on social media. We got people in the UK, Canada. I appreciate you all. There are lyricists and then there are wordsmiths.
Right.
There's a difference. I think they're completely different. And then I feel like when you merge the two, then you get a dope MC.
Okay.
That's how I feel.
Okay.
With that being said, in this era where I think we're lacking on dope MCs.
Okay.
You know what I mean? There's music. Don't get me wrong. There's a plethora of music coming out.
Right. Well, there's a lot of producers.
That's saving rap right now. That's the reason why producers are bigger than MCs.
Yes, now. Yes, the game done changed and that's bad.
Because it is terrible.
Yeah.
Because right now, here's the crazy thing. You could mute the vocals and the instrumental is still dope.
Yes.
But if you mute the instrumental, the vocals ain't dope.
No.
You know what I mean?
No.
What exactly, how do you feel right now about the music you've heard? And I'm talking hip hop that you hear coming out right now.
It's not for me. It's not for me.
Right.
Everybody has their choice. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
But I will say this because this actually, like, I have a conversation with my son on a regular basis. You know, he kind of gets upset at the conversation. He's probably just as hard-headed as I am.
Right.
So we go at it, and I think it's good for both of us. We sit there, and when we go at it for a good hour or two about music.
Right.
You know what I mean? And I love it. Like, I don't tell him that I love it. He's going to find out now.
You know now.
Right? But, you know, I love it because I'm trying to understand what is it with this youth generation that that they're in love with their type of music.
Mm-hmm.
You get what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah.
So I try to understand it. I don't want to be that person that doesn't understand it. Just like, yo, it's whack. Stop it. It's whack.
The old head that hate on everything.
Yeah, yeah. So I try to understand. Why do you guys keep saying we're hating?
Mm-hmm.
I got a little bit of it. And at the same time, he understood where I was coming from, where our generation is coming from.
Mm-hmm.
And basically, I'll say what I told him is that our generation was based on balance. Yes, you had your comedian rappers,
mm-hmm.
you had your party rappers,
right.
you had your conscious rappers, you had everything, and it was all balancing each other out.
Right.
You get what I'm saying?
Right.
So now everybody is just on mollies and
there's
whatever.
There's no balance.
Right. There's no balance to offset. Okay, yo, you were partying today.
Right.
Okay, but you don't party every day. You get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Now,
I
do have to say, right? But well, we might be too old to party anyway.
Yeah, can't keep up.
What I will say though, what I will say is that some of us are hating a little too much. And why do I say that? Because we still consider Dos Effects hip hop. And this actually just came to me this week. You know what I mean? We still considered Das Effects hip hop, and we thought it was the new thing. Now imagine our parents listening to Diggity Unga Bunga, right?
Yo,
and they're like, "This is what you're calling music." Look at it now. Look at it now, right? Let's look at it now and say Diggity Unga Bunga, and then we call that hip hop.
Hence my intro when I said lyricist and wordsmith. And you know what? I'm going to be honest with you. When I talk about music, and we talk hip-hop right now because I'm talking to an MC. And
right.
But on the regular, this goes to dance hall, it goes to reggae, it goes to whatever. Right. I tell people this all the time. Whack music is not new.
Yeah,
there's been dope MCs.
Yeah.
And there were whack MCs.
Yes.
There were dope singers, whack singers. Yes. You know what I'm saying? But the key word you mentioned was balance.
Yes.
So for every whack MC,
mm-hmm.
there was a dope MC to balance them out.
Yes.
But it does seem like right now, you got dope MC saying, man, I got to try this whack stuff because this whack stuff is selling. So I give you a perfect example. I was talking to Singing Melody, legendary reggae singer in the game. And he was talking to him about his album, that one on the wall. They call me Mr. Melody.
Okay.
When he was creating that album, there were some times when the producer was trying to throw the auto-tune on it because that was a style at the time.
Yeah.
But the thing about it is this. If you're a good singer, you're on key, auto-tune takes you off.
Off, yes, yes.
So you have to be talented enough to be able to sing off key.
Dumb it down.
And then let auto-tune do what it does. And it's hard. If you can sing, it's hard to go off key.
Yes.
You know, so it's the same situation.
Yes, it's hard to mumble when you're used to saying something. You know what I mean? It's hard to mumble when you're used to saying something. Like, I can't get on a mic and act like I'm talking to my daughter when she was like, you know, months old. I can't do that.
Right.
Matter of fact, even then I didn't talk to her in mumbles. So
you can't do it now.
I can't do it now. You know what I mean? Maybe when I'm older and then the teeth come out or something.
Then you're mumbling involuntarily.
But I'll still drop records.
Probably go gold, go platinum.
Right? Like, this is what it took.
It's crazy because even from this, because style is one thing.
Right.
Lyrics is another.
Mm-hmm.
The style is whatever. Because I tell you this, Busta came out and he had the whole woo-ha and the whole night.
The craziness.
But if you listen to the rest of his work and stuff like that, Busta is what I call a pressure. I would never do a duet. Busta is one of my favorite artists that I would never collaborate with.
Why?
Because he's going to show me up. Busta is that MC that I guarantee you, many rappers probably have to be like, back in the studio and come back out.
You know what? I love Busta.
I love Busta.
But I don't like the late work of Busta.
No, what?
Because every time now that he goes on, you literally have to stop the beat just to so he can show off the fast pace. And it's like, okay, this is still music, bro. Like, I still got to bob my head. I don't want to stop and just hear you go.
But they don't dance no more. Yeah. So it don't matter, you know what I mean? They don't dance no more. Those guys were prophetic. People don't dance no more. Yeah. All they do is this. So, you know what I mean?
But I get you. But it's mood music, right? It's mood music. So there's always a mood. Like, there's that mood that you just want to be like, oh, yes.
Yeah.
Oh, yes.
So you don't get that from Bus no more?
No.
I have the new material that he's put out, the one with Cartel, it's not my thing, but whenever I hear Busta on something, like, for example, when he was on the feature he did on Stephen Marley's joint the other day with him and Cardinal Official, check that out.
Okay.
Revelation Part 2, The Fruit of Life.
Okay.
He got, and I tell you this, Busta also, I think, does more justice on his features too.
Oh yeah, because he's got a pressure on his chest that he got to prove something, because he's never listed in the top 10.
No, he's never.
You know who else? I'm sorry, I got to do
it. No, go ahead.
Who else is never listed? And I'm tired of hearing people's top 10 and they do not list this person in the top 10. If you don't mention Slick Rick in the top 10, you guys got to stop. He is a pioneer. He is the original storyteller that just bodied it. He bodied it. Like, when you think of storytelling, you go directly to Slick Rick. How do you not mention him?
Yeah, but at first, I don't think there should be a top 10.
Well,
I honestly don't think that people should be creating top 10s. And the reason being is because it's fluid. There's some, yes, you've got that. Yeah. But what happens when somebody really good comes, because they're errors.
Right.
You know what I mean? And there are different errors where you have excellent people in it.
Right.
Because I don't feel like, though he's not in the top 10, Dre. And even Pac and him are not in the Slick Rick era. That's the era after.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
How many people can you really put in there?
Well,
you should do a top 10 for each era. But,
well, see, this is I'm gonna carry off what you're saying. This is why we can't do a top 10, because it's also biased. Like,
true.
If I ask you what's your top 10, it's gonna be based on something different than mine's. Mine's is gonna be based on solely MC lyrics, wordplay. So when you ask me who's better, Tupac or Biggie, I'm sorry, it's Biggie because of the wordplay.
Right.
You get what I'm saying? Right. Now, if you're telling me as far as who was more emotional, I think Pac is the most emotional rapper, period. Period.
And I choose Pac.
But see.
So I know exactly what you mean.
But if you ask me who's my favorite of all time, I'm going Big Daddy Kane, because that's where I switched up my game from writing like Run DMC to like, oh, man.
Right.
This dude right here, the punchlines.
Yeah.
And so if you listen to Big Daddy Kane and then you listen to mine, then you're gonna see. Oh, see the influence. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, he's Big Daddy Kane on steroids. or years later.
But you know, the evolution.
Right.
The evolution.
Right.
Because even when you talk about stuff like that, it's like, okay, what about the special eds? You know what I'm saying?
He was dope. He was dope. He's not in mind.
He's not top 10. When we bring it down generationally now, when I hear people talk top 10, somebody the other day was saying Ice Cube. And like you said, to be honest with you, you're absolutely right. Everybody's biased. Mm-hmm. You're a fan of something. Maybe somebody did some music that struck a chord with you, automatically made it into your top. Because when I hear people say top 10, I hear them going names, and I'm listening for DMX, and I don't hear no DMX.
Right.
That top 10's a lot.
Yeah, I mean, like, for real, like my top 10. Eddie Nice. I'm just kidding.
What about the boy Eddie Nice, though?
Yo, you got to put him in there.
Blessings, Ted. Thank you so much for logging in. Kurt. Oh, Kurt Brown says, hip-hop now is a trash. Boy, you listen to Green Gate, because that's where they got the real hip-hop. I'm not even going to lie. There's good stuff coming out.
Yeah.
But you got to dig too far to find it.
Yeah.
You got to dig beneath the BS. And a lot of times people get tired of that digging.
No, true indeed. You know what I mean? True indeed. And I think if we really want to stop like what's going on with the mumble rap, what we have to do as an older generation, I was thinking about this as well. We make way more money than these kids do.
Mm-hmm.
But we're not buying records. We're not buying anything.
True, because we're paying mortgage.
Yeah. But at the same time, we could change the game if we wanted to.
If we wanted to contribute to the culture.
Yeah. We're not willing to do that. We're willing to complain, but we're not willing to do that. And I hold myself fault to that, too, because I will download, you know.
And that's a music thing, though. It's not a hip-hop thing.
Yeah. You
know, I love music. I'm a consumer.
Right.
I do consume music. I do buy music.
Right.
The last hip-hop record that I bought was probably J. Cole.
Okay.
Not the latest stuff. I haven't really even heard. I'm kind of busy, so I haven't had the opportunity to listen a lot of stuff. But even Kendrick, with all the accolades that he's received, I don't own a Kendrick Lamar CD. Or what do you think about Kendrick?
Kendrick's a good rapper, and I said that, and I know what I said. I said a good rapper.
Right.
I don't think he deserves the accolades that he gets. I'm a firm believer. And I get crucified for this all the time, but bring the conversation to me. If you know me, then you know how much I love hip hop and how much I could talk this all day. So good luck. I hope you bring all your ammo with you
and a
bulletproof vest, because I'm coming at you.
Right.
So Kendrick, and it seems like anybody who's sponsored by Dre gets an automatic 3 million fan base.
Yeah.
And they get the illest push ever.
Everybody that's sponsored by Dre, including Dre.
You know what I'm saying? So name a person that Dre put out that really didn't skyrocket.
Yeah, you know what I mean?
Game wasn't even sponsored by Dre, but he kept using Dre's name and boom.
Skyrocketed.
You get what I'm saying? So it's kind of like that. And it was like that for Diddy for a minute, too. So
cosign.
Yeah, the cosign.
Homegrown with G Cole by Dre.
I happen to think J. Cole is a lot better than Kendrick Lamar.
I think so,
lyrically.
Too.
Even the punchlines. The punchlines are so sick. It's ridiculous. He just got to get out of his lane with the slow music all the time.
Right.
Get out of that lane. If you go back to what...
Hanging out with Wale and him.
If he goes back to his early mixtapes to what got him to where he was, to where he's at, I think the game would change a little bit.
I'm a J. Cole fan.
I'm a J. Cole fan.
I have heard, I put it this way, I tell people this. And I haven't heard all this stuff because I've just been too busy. Mm-hmm. Whenever I get, whenever I'm on vacation next, I'm going to like music overload.
Okay.
But I've never heard a J. Cole that I didn't like. I've heard Kendrick's that I didn't like. I've heard some Kendrick joints.
I heard a lot of Kendrick I didn't like.
Yeah.
And I listened to it and I'm like, somebody's got to tell me, what is it that you like about it? Maybe I'm missing something.
Right.
Like, I hear the lyrics. I hear it. And by the way, that annoying high-pitched sound that he uses for his voice, you might as well be auto-tuning. Like, what's the point of that? It's rap. You don't have to have a serious voice to
carry a message.
Yeah. I didn't like it when Nicki Minaj was doing it. I don't know why you as a man is following after that and doing it. Come on. Stop. Stop it. I'm sorry.
Kendrick, call us and explain yourself. All right? Call the Homegrown Show. Now, here's the deal. With your music, when I hear when I hear your stuff, you know, it always leaves me thinking, like, damn, it takes me back to a time when I used to spend money on hip hop music.
Ah, you know what I mean? I'm gonna start charging people. you just said it, man. I'm gonna start charging people.
That's how I feel. It's there were a bunch of great rappers, but when I put on a Pac, big.
Right.
The Roots, Nas, Dead Prez, right. Lauryn Hill, right. Scarface, Mos Def. It left me saying to, like, well, in my mind, I would never say it out loud, but to my mother and dad, I used to be like, yo, take that. You know what I'm saying? You think hip-hop is nonsense and no knowledge, take that. That's kind of how I felt, you know what I mean?
Right.
It's hard to feel that way these days. Talk to me about, outside of the successful rappers, the Jay-Z's and so forth. From your vantage point, not of that of an artist,
okay,
step out of the artist's shoes, but as a fan of hip hop,
that's easy.
Take away the names, but the music itself. What do you feel about where hip hop is right now? The culture.
Oh, I didn't know you was going there with that one. how do I feel about the culture?
Right.
To be honest, I honestly feel like everything has its time frame.
Right.
Hopefully, I'm gonna still be here when that time frame comes back. I don't feel it's far fetched right now.
Right.
It'll
circle right back around.
Yeah. It's gonna circle back around. One or two things. Half these kids that are mumble rapping are gonna drug themselves to death anyway.
Wow.
And then it's just
time.
Yeah. I mean, that's just realistic. Right. I mean, so hopefully, what you're talking about, you're not doing.
Right. Okay. Right.
Hopefully. And then not to mention that. What you're professing in your songs that your fans are doing, they're going to die too.
Right.
You get what I'm saying?
If that's what you're selling. Right.
So.
And we see it happening.
Yeah. So you guys are killing yourselves.
So eventually, you're saying mumble rappers and the mumble rap fans are going to be gone. Are we going to be?
Dos FX.
You ain't right.
Yo, I love Dos FX, man. I was a fan. But I had to look at it like how my parents would look at it.
Right.
Diggity Unga Bunga. Like, and we was like, yeah.
What about Onyx?
Onyx. Until they did that Snow Goons album.
Right. That's when the snow melted. Oh, man.
But Slam. But Shifty.
I feel like they have
React.
You could pull out the good joints.
Yeah,
that's the thing with Onyx. But I don't know if they should be up where people put them.
Yeah, no, I don't. They had a time though. They took over a whole summer.
But they took the time that they took over was with a limited amount of material. It wasn't. They weren't giving you albums worth of.
Right, they had.
I think there's like good five albums. Hot, but then from the two albums,
right.
I think I could pick out a total of over 5-6 joints.
You know who I miss? I'm gonna say it because right around that time frame, I'm gonna say I miss the Lost Boys, man.
Oh,
I really miss the Lost Boys.
That was my favorite group.
Oh man,
and I'm talking about I'm in Jamaica.
Oh man, I miss the Lost Boys, man. I do. I honestly miss the Lost Boys.
Sorry. No, that was one of my top. What am I talking? I'm talking about I'm in Jamaica.
The chemistry.
People underplay how much
what's Freaky Ty.
He's the second
best
hype man.
Second best hype man.
Second
only to Flavor Flav. Only to Flavor Flav. And yeah. that's a hard shoe to fill.
It is, because I tell you this, if you go in, even though it's just a little sound of it, whatever, if you went through those records and took them out, the songs ain't the same.
Yeah, no.
The song's not the same.
No, he brings life to it. He brings life to it.
Yeah. Lost Boys was the truth.
Yeah.
But I just feel like in this day and age, like I said, the balance is gone. I feel like the hip hop fader is very loose.
Yeah.
Picture the fader on the mixer.
Yeah.
And it goes from dope to whack easily. You know what I'm saying? It's not much. The fader's loose.
Yeah.
You're going from dope to whack easily. Now, we just played a couple of your joints, but you've got a ton of dope songs. I'm gonna drop something else for the masses right here.
So you're saying I got more than Onyx already?
I ain't say you did. You know, French will be running up in people's studios.
Hey, Fab J for life. ATL.
Oh. This one is, you know what I'm like, Redbone?
Yeah, let's do that. Let's do that.
By the way,
let's do that.
That beat.
Talk to me. Talk to me. Let's do it.
Keep it moving, keep it grooving.
Let's do it.
It is homegrown.
Chill. Woo. ATM. Let's go. Redbone in my fortress, in a dark room looking gorgeous. Candles got the torches, treat my bedroom like an office. Got her dripping like a faucet, I am dead ass where the corpse sits. Pipe game, flawless, she chuckles like Mr. Norris. After meowing like she Morris, she loud though, wild though. Sounding like a chorus, better scene set for a forest. But don't ignore this, had to write it like a tourist. Slow it down like that's the tortoise, pick it up like I'm the forklift. She loves that I'm a wordsmith, in other words, no one worth it. Her past friends are worthless, so on that note, it's perfect. I understand her purpose, paid attention to her purchase. Cost you nothing for these verses, free your mind, release the curtains. Blinded by the blinds, ignore the signs of me lurking. And now I'm on her line or on her mind like a turban. Swerving through her nerves and go figure why she nervous. Word is beautiful, we cutting like we cuticles. Address it cause it's suitable, feelings only mutual.
You must be crazy, I take that one from the top, ladies and gentlemen. That one is. That's all I'm gonna say, all right?
That means you like that one, brother.
That's not taking a chance.
Boss.
I'm digging that one.
Meet me at the bar.
I see that one live.
We're gonna video that one.
Redbone in my fortress, in a dark room looking gorgeous. Candles got the torches, treat my bedroom like an office. Got her dripping like a faucet, I am dead ass where the corpse sits. Pipe game, flawless, she chuckles like Mr. Norris. After meowing like she Morris, she loud though, wild though. Sounding like a chorus, better scene set for a forest. But don't ignore this, had to write it like a tourist. Slow it down like that's the tortoise, pick it up like I'm the forklift. She loves that I'm a wordsmith, in other words, no one worth it. Her past friends are worthless, so on that note, it's perfect. I understand her purpose, paid attention to her purchase. Cost you nothing for these verses, free your mind, release the curtains. Blinded by the blinds, ignore the signs of me lurking. And now I'm on her line or on her mind like a turban. Swerving through her nerves and go figure why she nervous. Word is beautiful, we cutting like we cuticles. Address it cause it's suitable, feelings only mutual. Baby girl, I'm cool with you. Hot when we physical, but not to sound so cynical. This shit about to get critical, for fuck's sakes, literal. Malicelessly beneficial. Official. Dead bones on the red bone. Leave the X alone, cause three of those is more official. The visual. Woo. It's like, damn. The visuals is crazy. Imagine that.
That was dope. That's a stay woke. Rhythm. Listen, Kurt, people be bringing up all kinds of stuff as we listen to them. You know what I mean? And I know we got some young folks out here that's going to break out in a minute. I said, yo. You know what I mean? Race Remed. But,
it was so good about a week ago.
You know what I mean? And that's the thing, the date stamp on them things. Kurt, big up yourself. Kurt Brown says, Redman. He loved Redman was dope. Not classic, but I bumped some Redman. Mobb Deep.
Mobb Deep
was dope.
Yes.
The Scarfaces.
Yes.
Of the
yes,
world. Yes. You know what I mean? Goody Mob was dope.
Goody Mob was dope.
And that was the time too when you're getting some good stuff from everywhere.
From everywhere, you
know?
Yes.
Right
yes.
now, I don't know. And I'm not hating on y'all. So I don't want these kids to, because me and my daughter be getting into it all the time.
Yeah.
You know, but it is what it is. I guess my appreciation for music is a little different from theirs.
Right.
Remember, I'm going to go spend my money on this.
Right.
You know, they're not accustomed to doing that.
No, you know what else they're accustomed to?
Mm-hmm.
I think this is a big thing here. What they're accustomed to is they're okay with there's two good songs from this artist.
Right.
We're to the point where we're like, well, not to the point. We were always like this where I don't want to hear no album fillers, man.
Right.
If I'm going to pay my money for this,
mm-hmm.
this better be a classic album, at least to me. Or
right.
you better have, it's 10 songs, 8 better be good. I'll give you 2 throwaways.
Right.
I'll give you 2 throwaways.
Yep.
But if you only got 3 good songs.
Yeah.
Now, I'm gonna say this. LL Cool J, he's a legend. He's always going to be a legend. I love this dude.
Mm-hmm.
He's never had a dope album. His greatest hits is going to be, it's the sickest thing ever.
Right.
Because he always, in every album, he has one classic song that you can hear 20 years later and it's still going to be dope to you.
Might give you a lot of fillers.
He gives you a lot of fillers.
Yeah.
But every album has, and some have 3.
Mm-hmm.
Some have 3 classic songs, but then the rest of the album is,
yeah,
is trash.
A lot of, and that's the reason why I appreciate you saying that, because mm-hmm. For the youth, again, we're not saying that everybody back then was dope,
right?
And everybody now is whack.
Right. That's not the statement.
Nah, because every now and then I stumble upon some stuff too.
Mm-hmm.
My daughter puts me onto some stuff. She put me onto this rapper, Eddie, what's his name?
Eddie Nice? No, I'm just kidding.
Ed Grant or something like that is what his name is.
Okay.
She put me onto one or two little people. She put me onto what's this girl from Chicago's name? Dej Loaf and people
okay.
like those.
Yeah.
Some young people who some are doing some stuff.
Yes.
But again, as I go through her stuff, it's the same thing. It's like LL's albums where, you know, the next 95 of them.
Yeah.
Boom.
Yeah.
You know, but that's this generation. Yeah. I think that's what the difference is, because we're coming from a time where we're going to go buy the whole album.
Right.
We had the 99 cent joint.
Yeah. We want to see a full-fledged artist, not you got lucky twice.
Yeah.
Because the clock is going to be on time twice a day.
At least. And the crazy thing about it is, these people are getting rich off of... man.
We doing something wrong. But then again, we don't control the game anymore. We don't control the game. We don't control the radio. We don't control anything.
Did we ever?
Well, you know what? We did. I think we did.
Radio?
Yeah.
How?
Yeah, because Hot 97 would literally play local artists. Kiss FM.
Mm-hmm.
At least this was me growing up in New York. They were local artists was coming on there, and
right.
and then you had Video Music Box with VJ Ralph McDaniels, which these kids today overprivileged.
Well, we were paying to see a video.
Listen, we didn't have cable, right? So we didn't have the MTV, VH1, so on and so forth. Matter of fact, the first time I seen Donnie Simpson, I was visiting my cousin in Rhode Island.
Wow.
And they had like Video Soul and Video Vibrations. And I was like, what the hell? Like, what? And this Donnie videos Simpson. All day? Like, this.
You got some kids right now saying, Donnie Simpson?
Yeah.
Related
yeah.
to Bart Simpson?
So if you grew up in New York, you had a Video Music Box, which was on like you know how you have the wind up televisions?
Right.
So you had the UHD channels, which was like the 33, 34, so on and so forth. So you had to wind that one. And then you would catch Video Music Box. I want to say it was like 4 or 5 o'clock, after school. So you get to watch it, and then he would pull out videos, and you'd be like, "I didn't even know these dudes was making videos."
Wow.
I mean,
wow.
You get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
He's a legend, DJ VJ Ralph McDaniels.
Right.
So he's a legend in New York, and he pioneered a lot of careers, man.
Right.
So and, you know, this was when we controlled
that way, MTV and all of. Dr. Dre and
that's how you mean your MTV Raps
yeah,
became.
Yeah. Yo, those are some nice good old days. The HD quality videos weren't up there, but
But I'll give history lessons, man.
Now everybody's going to YouTube.
Come with the bullets. Come with.
It's sometimes I wonder because even and again a lot of the things that we see going on in hip hop, it's not just relegated to hip hop music. Mm-hmm. It's across the board sometimes, and I always wonder why. Why is it that people make this certain type of music? Is it that that's where we are as a people in terms of we've all, because the fans, you know, you're selling something mm-hmm. and this stuff is generating revenue. Mm-hmm. So you're selling it to somebody. Somebody's buying it.
Right.
And when we say buy, that's relative also, because buy back in the day was buy. Now buy means streams or just listening right. to it somehow.
Right.
Is it just easier to sell BS right now?
Yes. Yes. Because you're riding a wave. Like, mm-hmm. Like I still do artist development, right? I love developing artists, and when you see them do something that you know they would have never ever done beforehand, right. and they really open up as an artist, it's like yeah,
right,
you got it,
right.
So I ask people, okay, well, are you looking for one hit, or right. are you really looking to make music? You get what I'm saying,
right?
Because even though I'm sure they look at you the same way. No, I think reggae might be a little different. I don't know if it is. You got to tell me on that. I can't have that competition.
Same.
But like, do they feel like your age, like after a certain age, you can't do this music anymore?
Sometimes the difference with reggae a lot of times pretty much is it's a double-edged sword where they do look at it that way, mm-hmm. but sometimes the validation does come from the older.
Okay.
You know what I mean? So it's a double-edged sword.
Oh, maybe it's like this. Maybe dancehall, you can't be that old. And roots, you can.
Yeah. That dancehall is more comparable to hip-hop.
Right.
You know, as is reggae to R&B in terms of you could have a baby face on stage right now killing it.
Right.
You know what I mean? And they appreciate that. It's kind of like with reggae. Dancehall, though, they kind of treat it disposably like they do hip-hop sometimes.
Okay. So my thing is, I mean, get used to me. Like, real talk. I mean, I should have never put it in the air. One of my favorite lines was, I will do this in my wheelchair, meaning forever. And sure enough, I got into a car accident and I was doing it in my wheelchair. So I proved my point. Sadly, I proved my point. But you know what I mean? I would never ever make a statement like that ever again.
Never.
I learned my lesson. I got it. Man. But I'm gonna keep making music. So I don't care if you feel like I'm too old or this, that, and the third, because you still get that, oh, damn. Did you hear what he said?
Right.
Come with your bullets.
But key word is hear what he said. Yeah. The thing about it is with this rap game nowadays is that even if there's punchlines and great lyrics in it, I don't know because I can't hear what you're saying.
But my favorite part mm-hmm. about being a lyricist / wordsmith, the wordsmith is very important to me.
Right.
Reason being, this is what I live off of. This is a little secret for you guys. When you listen to a song and you hear a punchline, and then the second time you hear it, you say, I didn't even hear this one.
Right.
Because usually my verses are filled with punchlines on top of punchlines. So every time you hear it, you're going to hear something different. And you're going to be like, wow.
So I got to go back and listen. Yeah. Got to keep. And that's throwback because mm-hmm. that was what real hip hop was based on.
Yeah.
Listening to, again, I'm into the lyrics. I give it, I agree Biggie had the flow.
Mm-hmm.
It's almost like when people compare Nas and Jay. I don't think you can. I more go to Nas because I'm into the poetry.
Right.
You know what I mean? But but the flow and the storytelling,
mm-hmm.
the Bigs, the Jays of the game, you can't deny.
Yeah. Here's the reference, right? Mm-hmm. I always say that hip hop is recycled. It's a recycled game. And I think it's gonna recycle again.
Mm-hmm.
So what you had was you had the two top dogs. I'm gonna say the three top dogs for me.
Mm-hmm.
The three top dogs were Big Daddy Kane,
mm-hmm.
Rakim,
mm-hmm.
and you had Kool G Rap. Mm-hmm. These were the wordsmiths.
Right.
And then what happens now is it flips. So Big Daddy Kane is Jay-Z.
Mm-hmm.
The flow and everything is similar.
Right.
The I'm still gonna have fun. I still got the swag, so on and so forth.
But I'm dropping.
Rakim and wordplay. Mm-hmm. Rakim was more lyrics. He wasn't really so much the metaphors. He mm-hmm. had a few metaphors, but he wasn't focused on metaphors. Right. So he had a story. He was more a painter with his words.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
So he painted a picture with his words, and he's Nas.
Right.
Nas. Like, I remember the one thing that Nas said that painted a picture, and I was like, this motherfucker is sick. Excuse my language. He was like, yo, and this is simple. So mm-hmm. I'm going to tell you that ahead of time. Mm-hmm. So don't be like, yo, you're a wordsmith, and that's what got you. He said, yo, I put my hat on my waves, right? And instead of just saying, put my hat on, he said, put my hat on my waves. So he painted a picture with details.
Right.
And then
right.
that's when I was like, okay, I got it. I'm stealing that.
Right,
From
right.
From here on in. You're getting details.
Right.
You're getting details. You know what I mean? So
paint a picture.
And that was it.
Wow.
You hear what I'm saying? So, and for me, Kool G Rap, who's a phenomenal lyricist, he could never ever get the right beats. Mm-hmm. He's AZ. I think AZ flows like water.
AZ is dope.
He's super dope. He's in my top 10.
AZ?
AZ is in my top 10. I've never heard a verse where I was like, that was off.
Right.
Never.
AZ is dope. The Firm.
Yeah.
AZ is dope.
Matter of fact, let's do it like this. The only person to sit on a Nas track and body him.
Wow.
On his first album, the classic album.
Right.
And he bodied Nas on that. And I love Nas, but he bodied Nas on that.
You know how many people are digging up right now? I'm going to go back.
Life's a bitch. AZ and Nas.
Wow.
And then they should have done a dual album together. And every time that they were featured together, they kind of like, they mesh well together.
They
work so well together. So whatever their beef is, I hope they just dead that, because so they
were still trying to hear that. You're still trying to hear that that collab.
Yeah, I'm not. That Nas album was. That last J. Cole album.
That's what I heard too. I still haven't gotten to it.
Yeah.
I don't know why. The last Kanye, which I ain't trying to listen to Kanye right now. I'm not going to front. The Nas that came out, even the what's her name? Tiana Taylor.
Mm-hmm.
I haven't gotten a chance to listen to any of those.
You got to talk to me. From the outside in. Okay. That whole Drake and Pusha T.
Oh, God.
What was up with that? What was your feeling on that? Again, I'm taking your show. Yeah.
What I thought about it pretty much is it was contrived on one side. And it's not real.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't feed into stuff like that.
Okay.
I think it was contrived in terms of, you know, and again, I wasn't there, but how did Pusha get that info?
Oh, he got it from Kanye.
How did Kanye get that info?
Because he talked. I think Drake is really that emotionally sensitive, and he just started talking. But
what was he out there for? He was out there to help Ye, right?
Right.
Okay. So you really tell me that you're a man. You're that kind of dude to where he was out there to help you.
Mm-hmm.
He confided in you, which you shouldn't have done.
Mm-hmm.
And then you came back around and filtered it out through your man. That was you trying to say something, but you made your mouthpiece do it. So that's the reason why I said stuff like that seems quite contrived to me.
I agree with you, but this drama has been going on for a minute,
mm-hmm.
and I don't understand what the hell you was thinking when you jump in a ring with a lion. And I might be biased. Shout out to S. Stewart that we used to work with. I'm not gonna put it in. I don't know if she wants her name out
right,
there.
Right.
Who's the aunt of the Clips?
Oh, she is.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. So remember, she used to sit next to me while we were working.
Chef Gigi.
Yeah.
What?
And she was like, and she's gonna laugh now. I swore she was lying, but she was like, "Oh, you want to go meet him?" And I was like, "Yeah, sure." And she was like, "Oh, yeah, they're gonna be down at South Beach." Uh huh. Yeah. She's like, "You want to go?" Yeah, let's go. We got in the car. We went down there. She's like, "Oh, yeah, they're gonna be at this hotel." Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I'm still not buying it.
On your way to South Beach.
Right. And she's like, "Oh, I'm calling and they're not picking up." Sure enough, you know what I mean? She's like, "Oh, I finally got in contact with him." Going to the door. No one's answering the door. Open the door. Malice. I'm like, "Oh." Oh, she's not lying.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. And then Pusha T came right after.
Big auntie.
Yeah.
Well, Gigi, I'm going to have her in here soon, too. We're going to talk about some of her endeavors.
Yeah.
That's my girl. Love her to death.
Yeah. She's super cool.
Love her to death.
Yeah. Every once in the blue.
Yeah.
We chat. It's dope. Yeah.
Malice got to get back in the game.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? On a Saturday, because Sunday he in church.
Yeah.
But it's stuff like that, yo. I'm going to be honest with you. That kind of turns me off.
Okay.
You know, because that's not a beef where, you know, it's, and Drake didn't respond, which I honestly think he took the high road by not responding properly. I would not have either.
I don't think he should have ever responded.
At all.
Yeah, I don't think he should have. Yeah. That's what I'm saying. He should have never walked into that ever.
Yeah.
Ever.
Yeah, it's they got bigger things to do.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Well, that L was coming a long time ago.
But that just shows, to me, that's a testament to the character or the lack thereof of Kanye.
Oh yeah,
I'm gonna be honest. But nobody's surprised with that.
That's what I'm saying.
So,
but then again, okay. So you've been going back and forth with Pusha T really for a while.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and now you're sitting in a studio with his head honcho. What were you thinking?
Well,
what were you thinking to even relieve that information?
That's the part. Yeah. Well, like you said, man's an emotional guy.
Yeah.
Some people are like that. You know, they just touch him and they start squealing.
Okay. Well, you know what? Stop making songs like, I put the napkin in my wallet because I'm thugging like that. You know, I'm mobbing like that. Whatever your line is. I don't know your line like that. But, yo, stop with those comments, okay? Stop. How about that?
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm telling you, they put it out there. We're just talking about it.
Right.
Now, we talk music, right? Mm-hmm. I did an episode on a radio show once about the myth of the missing black fathers. Mm. And man, did I get some responses on that.
Man, you should have had me on here, man.
Boy, for me, and don't get me wrong, I'm not saying that there are not people out there who are not being raised by moms only, but the concept that it is a norm within our community, I think is a real myth, right?
Right.
When I analyze my surroundings,
mm-hmm.
just speaking for myself, because that's the most accurate way to gather data,
right?
And that's pretty much the easiest way to gather data. I feel like, let's say there are 40 persons that I'm really close to.
All right, let me say this real quick because mm-hmm. I didn't do this. I didn't do this before. So shout out to my God-given daughters, okay? Because those are the ones that
mm-hmm.
that they weren't birthed through me, but I've been taking care of them and I love them to death. So it's the same rules apply. They still my daughters. So yep. Lexus, Gabby, Mia, yeah, there you go.
You're getting them whoopings. But the whole concept of the missing fathers, man, within our community, I think missing fathers are there, but it's not a black thing.
No.
I just cannot understand the image being put out there that black fathers are not raising their kids. And folks, again, I'm not saying it's not happening, right? But they're, it's not about absent fathers. There are absent fathers out mm-hmm, there, mm-hmm. but the concept that it's a black thing to me is ridiculous.
Well,
what do you think about that?
Well, we could do this really, really, really simple, man. Mm-hmm. And I love having intelligent conversations with you, man. It's real comfortable and easy when you can go back and forth with each other.
Right.
And not be like, okay, he has no bearing in this conversation. So let's do a ratio right now. Since we're talking about missing fathers and we're talking about black missing fathers.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. There's two black men in this room right now.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So we're going to go ratios, right?
Right.
There's two black men in this room right now.
Mm-hmm.
And both are fathers and both are present fathers. I don't need to say anything else.
Leave it right there.
Where's your ratio? Right now, we batting 100.
100. And the crazy thing is, again, let's expand,
mm-hmm.
right, to the next closest person to you,
mm-hmm.
family or friends wise.
Right.
They have kids?
Yep.
Aren't they there for their kids?
Yep.
All right.
Yeah.
So, again, I'm not trying to, because I feel bad, I'm not trying to make it seem like there are not women out there that aren't doing it on their own.
Right.
But to make it seem like that's commonplace within the black community,
mm-hmm.
to me is just, not only is it a myth, but it is wrong.
Yeah.
It is wrong for, and I did the whole research thing and I'd mentioned, I don't want to go that over in terms of how the concept is,
right.
how people gather their data, why they gather their data.
Right.
They were doing it for some form of funding, and they needed to gather data to prove certain things. And when if you're looking for data, you'll find it.
Yeah, yeah.
Like I mentioned on that show, yeah. if I need to do a stat on midget Asian people, I go to the Asian community,
right.
and I got to find one.
Right, right.
You know, so if you go searching for certain things, you're going
to
find it.
Right. So if you go to the courthouse,
mm-hmm.
into the section of child support,
mm-hmm.
I'm sure you're going to find some deadbeat dads there.
Yep, of all shades.
Yeah, yeah.
But what they're doing is this. When they go for that data, right,
mm-hmm.
guess which courthouse they go to? They go to the one in the black community.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So it's something that kind of rubbed me the wrong way. But I mentioned it primarily because we go back,
mm-hmm.
right? And again, back to them songs and in the Dropbox. I got it. You know what I mean? I was a young father. You were a young father,
yes,
too.
Yes, yes.
Raising these little kids.
But didn't shy away at all.
Not at all.
Took it on.
Not at all.
Put it on my back. I can't see nothing different.
I couldn't do it any other way.
Yeah.
Now, what I want to know is this. As much as hip-hop meant to you,
mm-hmm.
being a father and a great father to your son was way more important.
100%.
Start with this. Why was it important? It's a dumb question, but it's a real question. Why was it so important for you to be there for him?
Okay. I'm going to sidetrack and get back to this if I can.
Yep.
Because I had a conversation with another gentleman, another black gentleman who's also a father.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, he was having a conversation with me and he said, you know, I respect you so much as a father, man. And he goes, and I honestly think that you got a great father.
Right.
And he obviously doesn't even know my dad. I'm like, well, why would you say that? Because for you to take on a task that you've taken on, you must have seen a father and seen what a father can do, which is why you took on a task. Because honestly speaking, when it came to my son, I pretty much took care of him by myself when he was two to 17.
Right, right.
You hear what I'm saying? So it wasn't like I was with his mom or this, that, and the third. No. See, I kind of did this. I did the single father thing from 2 to 17.
Right.
So he was saying that you had to have seen that you were able to do it. And he made a valid point. Like, it really triggered that. The problem is that if you don't see it, you can't think that it can be done.
Right.
You get what I'm saying? So
you grew up with your father.
I grew up, my parents divorced, they separated, and I grew up with my mom, / grew up with my dad.
Right.
Like, at but different times.
He was there.
Oh, he was there. He was there.
And that's another part of the equation.
Yeah.
Because my thing is, I grew up with both parents, too.
Right.
And just to further solidify the fact that this is myth, we're talking about our generation. You, me, people our age, and their children. We're there for our kids.
Yes.
But truth be told, I also don't know, I'm not saying it's not out there. I also don't know any people amongst my peers
Right,
their dads weren't there too.
Right.
So where is this?
Yeah.
Where's this coming?
Yeah.
And we grew up in two different countries.
Yes. 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 So I grew up knowing that I could be a dad, and I mean, I told my dad that I was gonna go for custody, and he point blank was like, "I'm right there with you, man.
Right.
My pocket's your pocket. Whatever you need, let's go through this."
Wow.
That was an eye opener.
Right.
That
right,
was
right.
Like, okay, oh, I'm going in. I'm going in.
Right.
And you know, I never shied from it. So back to your question. I'm sorry.
I
had to say that.
No, because I
think it's very
that.
Important. You know what I mean?
That, I definitely appreciate that.
So if we as fathers talk and people see that, oh, it can be done, they're more likely to do it.
Right, right, right.
Okay.
Right. No, that's cool, because and for those people who subscribe to the notion, and you know what, even before I get to that, what I was trying to figure out is within you, because a lot of times,
what was more important?
With you and a relationship to your son, what was it? Why was it so important to you? Because there's a lot of things going on, and it's a tough battle to fight.
Yeah.
But as in inside you, taking him out of the equation, why was it so important for you?
Why was it important for me? Is because I was just built to take on my responsibility, whatever it was. I've taken so many beatings. And I mean by, like, my parents. Like, you know, I had to own up to stuff. You know what I mean? So I don't think it was ever really a question. And the fact that, to be honest, another part was, I mean, it is what it is. I didn't want to do it. But as far as his mom, my son's mom, I am 100% better parent. I couldn't let him do that. I couldn't let a part of me deteriorate like that.
That
wasn't going to happen. And it sounds harsh, but it is what
it is. It is what it is.
Yeah. So I wasn't going to do that.
Because people automatically assume a lot of times that if there's a choice, mom's going to do better. No.
No. No. Mm-mm. No. I wasn't going to let him do that. You know what I mean? So I was going to give him every opportunity. And that was that.
I love it.
That was that. There's no questions.
Now, you went through the whole nine, right?
I'm
talking about financial stuff, because that stuff ain't cheap.
Court 4 times a year, every year.
Man.
4 times a year, every quarter.
Mm-hmm.
Every quarter. Every business has a, like, they do their end finances at the end of the quarter.
And you are funding the court's end financing at that point in time.
I put my lawyer's kid through college, man. Stop it. Stop it.
Now, what I'm going to ask you is this. For those people who subscribe to this notion that, as a man,
because
I'm not going to lie, I felt that way at one point too. It's like, as a man, you can't win that battle in court. What do you say to them?
You can.
Right.
A lot of times, we lose because we don't want to continue fighting. Or we already have the notion that we can't win. Now, you can't go into a boxing match knowing you can't win and think you're going to win. That just doesn't happen.
Right.
You gotta be able to say, look, either I'm going to win or I'm going to die trying.
Right.
You
got to
do that 50 cent get rich or die trying.
Right.
And that's it. I wasn't going to lose. I'll be honest with you.
Right. No matter how long.
No.
No matter how expensive.
And don't get it confused. I'm not trying to tell you it was all, you know what I mean, grass is green. There was a lot of nights that I was drinking Because right, I was right. like, there's chapters to that fight.
Right.
There's
right.
There's a lot of chapters to that fight. And there was little wars that I lost in those fights. Mm-hmm. And I didn't... It's hard to explain, but there's right. things that didn't go my way. I'm mm-hmm. not going to say I lost, but they didn't go my way. And so, you know, you'd go home and you couldn't understand how things went the way that they went.
Right.
And, you know, you drinking and so on and so forth.
Drowning that pain.
Yeah. Drink away the pain, baby.
Then you got to get up in the morning and fight that battle again.
All over again.
But it was worth it.
It was worth it, man. I love it. I mean... Two before the final judgment, and the final judgment still wasn't the last case, by the way. Mm-hmm. But two before the final judgment, man, I was ready to put my legs up on the courtroom table, like, go ahead, go ahead, do what you do. I got this. Like, right. this is done. Like, I literally went into my closet, took my dad's tie, because that's how I was just like, right.
I got it.
Yeah, I'm gonna do this for the fathers right now. You know what I mean? I'm gonna do this for the fathers. Yeah,
I love it.
And you watch the panic on the other side of the table, like,
right.
too little, too late.
I love it, man. And I go this over because I think it's so important.
Yeah.
You know, the stereotype and whatever is being fed out there is just so wrong. And I wasn't going through the same fights, mm-hmm. but you got no idea how inspired I was. And I know it's not just me. Right. You know what I mean? Sometimes you're inspiring people and you have no clue.
Right.
You got no clue. Now, knowing all of that,
mm-hmm.
how does your son react to you right now, knowing that you went all out for him, literally.
It's still anytime you go to a court battle, the only person that really, really loses is the kid.
Right.
You
right.
know what I mean? I think that he's been begging for his mom's attention,
mm-hmm.
and she still doesn't know how to be a parent, so that still doesn't really work. So, you know, it took a lot for me to learn to kind of like let go and let him
figure his part.
Yeah. But there's a lot of times that he does have a conversation with me where he's like, man, Dad, you have no idea. You're that conscious that sits on the side of me, and I hear you talking all the time. And,
right, right.
You know,
right,
and then the aggravation of me repeating to you over and over again kind of goes out the window. Like, it's like a refresh button. Like, oh, okay, well, at least you're listening.
Right.
I didn't think you was listening.
You never think that.
Right.
I say that all the time. Keep talking to your kids.
Yeah.
Because we don't think that they're listening.
Right.
And they are.
Right.
Don't take everything in. But yeah. they are. My daughter makes fun of me all the time. She says, every time I start, she says, you sound like your grandma. You sound like your mom.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then when I hear her talk right now, I say, oh, yeah, you sound like me. Because
yeah.
she regurgitates, so they are listening.
Uh-huh.
And it goes both ways, too. So if you put some negative stuff out there, they're listening to that, too.
Diggity unga bunga.
That ain't right.
That's the topic of the day. Diggity unga bunga. Again, I love DOS Effects. And I love Onyx, too. So
right. Trust me. Now, when I put out the flyer
mm-hmm.
that we're going to be having in studio,
mm-hmm.
I purposely put on the tag, Triumph. Over tragedy.
Okay.
Now, let's talk about the accident. The crazy thing is this, E.
Mm-hmm.
And this is how life goes by so fast, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you know people, you know them well.
Right.
Sometimes somebody's gone, and because our life is so fluid and things are moving so fast, because it happened to me before where somebody said to me, nobody said it to me, I saw something on a Facebook timeline.
Mm-hmm.
And just like even with my mom, it pops up on the timeline, somebody said, oh, I'm sorry to hear, blah, 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 but this is 2-3 years ago,
mm-hmm.
right? So this is how life is.
Right.
But I didn't even know until you and I spoke recently.
Right.
That you had. But talk to me about that accident. What was the deal?
You want to know about the accident? You want to know the aftermath of the accident? You want to know?
No, not the details of what happened.
Okay.
But, you know, as far as when and how it affected you.
Okay. October 10th mm-hmm. is when it happened.
Mm-hmm.
And I was in a cycle mode, man.
Right.
It's just I make music. I'm doing artist development. I'm doing a show. I'm doing a radio interview. It's a cycle.
Mm-hmm.
It's a cycle. And I say this all the time, and people don't believe me. Like, it was no dreaming. If I dream, I'm dreaming with my eyes open. Like, I don't dream because I'm so exhausted
right.
after everything that I've done that I put my head on a pillow, I am knocked out. That's it.
Right. You know what I'm saying? Right.
Not to mention there's times that alcohol is involved, so. Literally, I put my head down. I'm gone. That's it.
Right.
You know what
right.
I mean? Till the next morning and do it all over again.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like that accident literally was a gift and a curse. It told me I was moving too much and that I needed to stop.
Right.
You know, you go into a dark place
mm-hmm.
Because you really can't move. You can't put your underwears on. You can't do that. Not to disgust anybody, but it's a dark place. And I don't know if you know, like, I used to be a runner.
Right, right.
So I'm gonna do what my boys hate when I do, and everybody else who knows me, yo, 4-time MVP in high school, district and regional champ, holla at me. All right, so got the trophies to prove it. You know what I mean?
Right, right, right.
You know what I mean? I got the times anyway. So, and my boy said it best when he came in. He was like, yo, when I heard that it was your leg, I was like, yo, not his legs. Because even to that day, I still go running. I can't run right now.
Right, right.
You know what I mean? So that's a whole nother world.
Right.
Then the fact that you're laying down in this bed pretty much 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, they can't show enough different Maurys. I mean, the hospital got, what, 7 channels maybe?
Right, right. How long were you in the hospital for?
I was in the hospital, then I was in the rehab. Mm-hmm. And then when I was out of the rehab, then I was at home and I couldn't move. So either way, you was in jail.
Right.
I mean, I hate to take away from the people that are really in jail, but So you only get to work out 2 hours a day. 1 hour is for the arm workout, and for the upper body, and the other hour is for the lower part of the body. Mm-hmm. I mean, there was nothing wrong with my upper body. Like,
right.
I'm like, yo, it's my leg. It's my leg, bro. It's my leg. Right. So you get into a dark place, and everything that you never dreamed of, dreaming is important. Mm-hmm. Everything that you think about is very important.
Right.
I used to hate working at Carnival just because I would go to sleep and dream numbers. Right?
I know what you mean.
Right? Like, damn, if this guy cancels, my bonus is going to look like this. You know? So, you think, like, your brain is still working when you sleep. Right. And I took that away from myself.
Right.
So all my demons, and demons doesn't necessarily mean bad things that you that you did. It's just the everyday thoughts that you go through and you solve in your own head and this, that, and the third. I didn't do that. Mm-hmm. So while I'm sitting in the hospital, my brain is now on overdrive.
Right.
And I can't do anything. I can't even sleep. And your brain just doesn't shut off.
Right, right.
So you go into a deeper, deeper depression where it's and if you do happen to get lucky to get some sleep, the nurse comes in, time for your shot.
Right. Damn.
And you want to stab the lady. I promise you.
Damn.
I promise you. So the bed is not comfortable. You're sitting there sweating in that bed. Okay? So you got to change the sheets on a regular basis. It hurts to get up. It's a deep depression, bro.
Right.
What I did learn from it was, I got off on the fact that I was in control of everything that I was doing.
Right.
That was a wake up call that I'm not in control of anything.
Right.
Yeah, you can only control so much, and then
you're in a passenger seat.
Yeah.
Wow.
So that's what I learned. So every song that I got stashed, I'm gonna push forward, and unless my son says, "Yeah, I want to go ahead and have that,"
right.
I'll give you my whole catalog.
Right.
I have no, my hard drive crashed, and that's never really like me. I'm too organized for that, but it happened.
Right.
I have no problem working on new music.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, I know you know that is. I'll go in the studio today, make a whole new song out of, you know what I mean?
Right.
And I could sit in the studio all day long with 2 cups of coffee.
Right.
Not eating. Matter of fact, that should be my new diet, the coffee diet. But you know, I could
caffeine,
do that.
Caffeine, maybe.
But I could do that, and that's what's wonderful about this.
Now, as far as all that goes, how does that affect the artist you are today? With everything that you went through, how does that affect the artist that you are today?
You know, what was dope about me, and you could tell me if I'm wrong, I never had a problem with being not an emotional rapper, but I have no problem putting
it out there,
putting my soul on a record. So if I want to talk about this, I'm gonna talk about this. I want to talk about, you know what I'm saying, a girl, I'm gonna talk about a girl. If I want to talk about, yo, there's some crazy shit that happened, I'm gonna talk about that. Mm-hmm. And I know that people stay away from lanes like that, but I honestly consider myself a musician. I don't really want to consider myself a rapper because you're not going to put me in a lane. I'm not a gangster rapper. I'm not a gangster rapper because you may hear a gangster song and then the next one's a girl song and you're like, yo, how the hell he did that? No, don't put me in no lanes. My pen works, you know what I mean? Right. And I'm going to talk about anything that I want to talk about. Good Morning World literally came from me just waking up in the morning, like, good morning.
Right, you know what I mean? This life thing, I love it.
Yeah. So it's everyday life. So I can't really say that it changed me. It might have made me, I guess, reach down deeper. Mm-hmm. And now I had a whole, because life support is what this upcoming LP is going to be. Mm-hmm. And now I have a whole nother section to write about.
Right, right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
So it's like you just gave me new material.
Right.
But I've never had the problem of you know, putting my soul on the track. So I don't think that's a problem. I think now I'm gonna push more forward at going at it. You know, I got the financial to back it.
Right.
So I'm gonna go more at it. And the fact that I've learned to not spread myself so thin.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like I can't do that. I just can't do that. Like, I'm sorry.
So there was knowledge in that tragedy, pretty much.
It was a lot. It was a
gift. You come out of that dark hole.
I think it was more a gift than a curse. Yeah. Yeah. Except for the fact that I can't play basketball.
Right.
I mean, I tell the boys that I play basketball with that, yo, all right, but just you got to bring a big dude that doesn't really want to run so much, and I'll stick him. Like, you know what I mean? And that whole running around, that ain't happening right now. I got to work on my jump shot. Me going in is not going to happen.
Man, it's all good. You get back to it. How long have you been out of the wheelchair and back on your feet?
Actually, I beat the time frame that was expected of me. Mm-hmm. But again, that's one, being an athlete. That's two, I can't sit still.
Right.
Like, you're killing me right now. Right. There's like, you want to leave me in a hospital? Cool. But then bring my laptop, bring the sound card, you know what I mean?
Right.
Come on, I need to do something. Like,
the mental beatdown is worse than the physical beatdown.
Come on, my brain waves are moving.
Right. Damn.
Yeah.
I feel you.
So, yeah.
That's what it was. Well, you know what? I'm going to drop something for them right now, and I know this came after.
Okay.
All right, so I'm going to drop this one. Again, ladies and gentlemen, what I normally do, a lot of times you don't know what's coming in, what order it's coming in, whatever the case may be. Because it's for my entertainment, too.
All right.
You know what I mean? Keep it moving, keep it grooving.
What's this?
This, I ain't telling you nothing.
Oh, bars. It don't matter. It's bars. Your boy Precise, back in the building again, my man Eddie Nice. Welcome to WNIC Radio. Hit the blaze down once again. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Aight.
2018, new year, no fear, straight out the wheelchair.
Life support.
Felt weird to cut the beard though.
Aight.
Fuck it.
Get busy gang, ATM, FJ, Hollow.
I never brag, how will I keep it? Empty bags for familiar reasons. Broke summer, stumbled off to all seasons. Leaving prayers for the non-believers. Storm in a room, like boom, a couple goons, like a foreign leader. The true seekers only hear me on their beat speakers. Sweet as candy when their ears receive us. Never lost when the Uber leaves us. Jump in the coupe with Jesus. Ghost right into some new releases. I'm in the proof, 100 proof. Either boots or sneakers. Dons or divas. Shorty waving like a brush Caesar. Greet me out the stool like it's cool. With no eager. Hand the keys up. Doors ajar to the car. Then it's back seat with a knee. Up. The dime piece of track pleaser came from a long line of rhyme schemers. Speaking verses from a trapper keeper. The trap rappers keep up. See us putting cuffs on your social media. Then teasing you like good luck. Read the caption on the currents with the teacups. Swear I'm forever where the mad rappers re-up. Whack rappers give they seat up. Beef what? The words back. All you nerds need to read up. If you ain't having it, then good. Me either. Woo! 2018, I'm back for everything. Clean up. Yeah. Life support. Let's go. Look, I'm off the hook like a chucker when the fisherman cooks. Off the books like a nooker, like a crook. I still got what it took. Shook ones never get shit done. Sip something and spit something where the brims hung. And where I'm from, crumbs still equal sums. Only dum-dums go numbs with when the tongue's lit. What's the conflict? Listen when the don spit. Piled on my kamikaze shit. Heading for the top of something positive. Tell them pause all the gossiping. The spitter backs it out. Everything is obvious. 2018, I'm showing promise on my dominance. Never been shy, though I ride with that common sense. I'm back running shit. I'm on my marathon.
on. Asking like flex, who gon' bomb it next week? What's a bomb threat? Really, what's your conflict? Your competence. So either spit something complex or nothing less. Cause off the chest, this is all for rep. Often blessed, this is all finesse. What you guess? Let's address whatever's left is only second best. Forever stressed, you could never rest. My relevance is taking precedence. Thank you for your compliments. Life support, I'm back for that. Yes. Yes.
Yes,
that's nice. Back one thing. Let my fan base sing. ATM cash register ring. Easy, what up, nigga?
You already know.
I swear that car accident woke me up, man.
Welcome back.
Life support.
Yo, let me tell you something. Let me tell you something. Here's the first time I heard this joint right here was on YouTube.
Okay.
All right.
Okay.
And
That means he subscribed. So everybody listening, please subscribe. It's Eddie Nice.
Go do that.
Please.
Go do that.
Please.
It's real stuff. And when I heard it, and I heard you say, since the wheelchair and the car accident woke you up,
uh-huh.
I backed up because then I was like, what? Because yeah. I didn't hear about that.
Right.
And then I backed up and I started looking and I was like, once you said that, then I'm like, is this just some dope lyrics? Or whatever. And I was looking, I'm like, and then I started seeing, I think you were in the wheelchair.
Dude, no. I was sitting down.
You were sitting down.
I was sitting down though.
Oh, okay. Because I was sitting down in the booth. Seated.
Yeah.
Yeah. I was like, and that's when it started.
You know, everybody keeps saying that. Like, yo, I wasn't in the wheelchair.
But you were seated.
I was seated.
Yeah, but here's what I get from that.
Mm-hmm.
A vivid, like we spoke about it earlier.
Mm-hmm.
The vivid painting of a picture. I focus on lyrics a lot.
Mm-hmm.
People ask me all the time, who's your favorite singer and whatever, I break it down.
Right.
My favorite songwriter, Stevie Wonder.
Okay.
Reason being, and I attribute it to, I think his visual impairment
mm-hmm.
puts him in a position where he has to make it visual.
Visual, right.
So when we talk cliche and we say, you see what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
When I listen to Stevie Wonder, I see what he's saying.
Yeah. You know what I'm saying? That's that Nas for me, see?
Trust me. And, yeah. And that's what I got. This one was so visual because, you know, a lot of times you listen to YouTube, uh-huh. you're not paying attention to the optics a lot of times. Sometimes mm-hmm. you're doing stuff, you're listening. But the visual was so clear that I actually had to look at the video and be like, what?
And it put you there.
I don't even want to go
to another artist, but that's why I don't really feel Kendrick Lamar like that.
Mm-hmm.
But who I do feel from the West Coast, my top dog for the West Coast is Nipsey Hussle.
Oh, Nipsey's dope.
Yo, when he talks, it's like, yeah, I believe you. I believe everything you're saying right now. He paints a picture. Nipsey's dope. He paints the picture.
But I don't know why. It seems like there's a little threshold that he ain't getting over.
Yeah.
Ain't getting over.
Yeah. And
he don't have the Drake cosign? Cause he's a part of the top dog, right?
For me, he is, right. and I've been talking to everybody around me about him for a long time. The Crenshaw mixtape is a phenomenal. It's so versatile,
mm-hmm.
and you'll love it. You'll love it
because
it's straight up like classic hip hop, and he's a West Coast dude.
Right.
But the last album he put out, the Victory Lap, that everybody liked, I didn't really like it that much. It was all right. It was good, but
right.
It was Crenshaw was crazy. But anyway, so yeah, I'm sorry.
No.
But I had to do that. That's my top dog for the West Coast.
Nipsey's dope.
Yeah.
Nipsey's dope. Talk to me about, now let's go to the booth.
Let's go to the booth.
All right. What's been happening since you were back home?
Home.
Since you got up and said, you know what? I'm on my feet. Maybe not literally at the time,
mm-hmm.
but emotionally and mentally. What's been happening?
Oh, man, that's home, man. I love that place, man.
Yeah, that's a sanctuary.
Ah,
that's where you come alive.
Ah, can I get one more?
Ah, need a harmonizer.
Matter of fact, during those court cases, that's what was my sanctuary as well. Mm-hmm. So if you listen to the Eddie Nice, the Incredible mixtape, volume 1, volume 2, volume 3, all those were during court time frames.
Right.
So I did those mixtapes during court time. And it was just taking songs off the radio, and that's why it was mm-hmm. easy for me to do Redbone. You know what I mean? And it was like that was building your skill, because it's like I hate to hear a remix and a person's off topic of what the remix is about. So
I'm
doing a song Redbone, so I got to talk about a Redbone. Like I got to mm-hmm. make the song make sense
right.
because I can't trust your pen if like. Jeezy had a song with Mariah Carey. Mm-hmm. I don't know what the hell they was thinking of putting them two together as far as a remix, but obviously she's talking about love, and he's still talking about coke. Like, what are you talking about, bro?
Love makes you high.
Yeah, like, bro, are you kidding me?
Oh, I hate those songs, man. When they just piece it together, it's like, you know what? Two dope people in a good place in their careers. Money's gonna be made on this. Let me just,
doesn't always mesh. That's bad for music. Yeah. I take music too serious. You know what I mean? But the booth is home for me, man. Like, I love it. I love the feel, man. And when I did Redbone, mm-hmm. you asked my protege, Wayne Easy.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I called him up, and I was like, yeah, I'm going to put a song in your Dropbox. And so I put the song in the Dropbox.
That was Redbone?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
And so... like, he's still on the phone with me. I'm like, go ahead, play it. And I'm just like, he's like, yo, what? No. Play it. And he could hear me. I'm already like, you have no idea.
I know I got something.
Then called my cousin Q. Q is my quintessential ear.
Right.
Like, he'll tell me, like, we're both Leos.
Right.
We're cousins.
Mm-hmm.
We're literally days apart.
Right.
So us two in the studio, we're two lions.
Right.
Everyone's going to think that we're going to fight.
But it's the process.
It's the process that we go through.
Right.
And we're
right.
yelling at each other because I know what I want and he knows what I'm capable of.
Right.
So
is he a producer?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay,
so
okay,
he'll be like, nah, you didn't come with it. You know what I mean?
He's bringing the best out of you. He's Kobe-ing you.
Oh, yeah, yeah. So we'll be at each other's throat like, through the whole process. And then when the song's done, it's like, ah, yes.
I appreciate the beat there.
Yeah, I hate the yes men's in your camp. Like, I hear songs and I'm like, how they let you leave the studio with that?
I'm glad I didn't have to say that. Yeah. That's something I go through a lot. It's, I swear to you, when somebody sends me something, I had a conversation with a good friend of mine who's an artist too, and it was just an honest conversation.
Right.
And I always put a disclaimer out there. If you're going to feel a way about it,
right.
or if it's not really the truth, if you want me to tell you, yo, fire.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? As your boy, I'll tell you, yo, fire. In that tone.
I won't tell my secret. I won't tell my secret.
But yeah. if you want the truth,
yeah,
that's trash. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But I always say... here's the thing. That's why I always think it's wrong to go in the studio with a bunch of people. Go in there with you, the producer, and if you need somebody to help you write a line or two, cool. But first of all, anything that's played
don't touch
over...
touch my pen, though.
No.
Don't touch my pen. I'm just saying, don't touch
that's
pen.
That's you.
Nah.
Anything that's played too loud sounds all right.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Anything. But when you turn down the volume, you gotta listen to that. That's the other thing. And then the other thing pretty much is, your boys are always, no matter what you do, especially if they got no talent... Yo, everything you do is off.
I hate it. I don't want to make it sound like that. Like, but there's none. I mean, my boys are trained, and I don't mean trained like a doggy trained.
Right.
But if you say it's all right, that means it's trash. You don't want to hurt my feelings. I need you to hurt my feelings because I don't need somebody outside of our circle
to hurt my feelings. Yeah. Yep. We need that.
Yeah. So tell me straight up. I ain't feeling it, man.
Because you're emotionally attached to the song.
Yeah.
It may be coming from a personal place.
Yeah.
It means a lot to you.
Yeah.
It's garbage, though.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. It's dumpster juice. It's dumpster juice. Say what it is. It's dumpster juice.
So I appreciate the honest criticism, man.
Let me go push your teeth. Ugh. No, but you have to have that, man.
Man, you
can only become a better artist. And with Wayne Easy, by the way, so yeah, I played it for my cousin,
mm-hmm.
and so Q was listening to it, and I can't even contain myself. I'm jumping up and down in my seat, like saying, "Damn, that shit is dope."
Yeah, right.
I know. I'm all over the place. I'm standing up. I'm doing jumping jacks. No, I'm not really doing jumping jacks.
Right. Not right now. Not right now.
But
you're doing these.
Yeah, but like for Wayne Easy, when he's recording, I got to tell him a couple of times, like, yo, nah.
Right.
Nah, do it over. You want me to do it over? The whole thing, do it over.
Right.
Yo, man, but it was, no, do it over.
Right.
But I'm training you to hear yourself and to learn to do it perfectly. because a lot of these young artists also just want to do a one run through. You're not Jay-Z, bro. And understand this. Even when Jay-Z does it, he's been doing it for so long.
Right.
When you do it for so long, it becomes easier.
Natural. Yeah.
Like, yeah. I could sit and rap and still sound like I'm standing up and rapping.
Right.
Some people can't do that. Right. But I've been doing it so long. You know what I'm saying? Right. So.
Hey, man. Honest criticism.
Yeah.
Talk to me about life support.
Life support, man. I think it's a beautiful body of work.
Right.
One is about the hospital. There's one joint that I think everybody's going to love. It's different. It's not my normal. And it's called Like Me.
Mm-hmm.
That song is a different perspective,
right.
And it's about a girl, mm-hmm. And she's just picking all the wrong guys. But what she really wants is a guy like me.
Right.
But that song is dope. I promise you, that song is dope. Marco Polo, I produce Marco Polo.
I love Marco Polo. Because you're a producer too.
Yeah.
How many of the joints on there do you produce? And is it hard to produce yourself?
Is it hard? No, because I know my sound.
Okay.
You know what I mean? So I don't want to produce all my own stuff because then I think that's J. Cole's problem. Then you stay stuck into that one sound and it's bad.
Right.
It's bad. I don't want to
sound. Need some outside ears.
Yeah. But Marco Polo's dope because it's my normal Eddie Nice bars. It's metaphors on top of metaphors. Right. And it's Marco Polo. It's my competition. I don't see you, Marco Polo, baby.
Wow.
Marco, come on. Look, even the title's a punchline. Everything is a punchline, baby. Come on. You got to think about it.
Yeah. Oh, I'm looking forward. I can't wait.
My comp is Marco Polo. I don't see them.
Damn. How many joints on there? How many joints?
Right now, we are 10, I think. We are 10.
Are you done? You going to put some more in there? We're in the era right now. People trying to put out 7, 8, 9 songs.
Yeah, I don't know, man. You know, I love making music, so there's nothing to just...
And you executive producing it too, right?
I do it all, man.
So there's nobody telling you stop.
No. Okay.
So we might end up with one of them Chris Brown joints.
Don't stop my pen. Don't stop my choice. Don't stop, man.
So we're going to get a Chris Brown 50 songs?
Yeah. No, and I don't want to sound arrogant, but like I really study this game.
Right.
You know what I mean? Right. Like I really study this game and I don't ever stop studying this game.
Right.
You know? So You know when you're putting together an album, it has to go up and down. You can't have I don't know what the hell Drake was thinking. All your up tempo songs on one side and slow songs on that. That's a disaster.
What? First of all, did you listen to the album?
I didn't. But when you tell me that all the like rap songs are on one side and then the R&B's on what?
I haven't listened to it.
I have no interest to
it. But I haven't seen any good feedback.
No, and then people tell me when they do say, "Yo, try this song. This song is dope." And I listen to it. I'm like, "No, it's not."
And this is an artist that I give credit where credit is due. This is an artist that makes good songs. I don't put him in my. He makes good songs.
No, he has good songs. He makes good songs too because he made that Jamie Foxx song. So
But I mean, I guess let me clarify.
His catalog.
His catalog is heavy.
Yes, is
heavy.
Agreed.
And when I say good songs, I mean, when I have conversation, people are like, okay, well, they start crediting the writer. What I don't understand is when it comes to hip-hop, if somebody puts out a good song and you don't want to credit him, then they start going back to the writer. Did he write it? Nobody asks if Whitney wrote them hits.
No, but that's a different game, though. R&B, right? Okay, mm-hmm. So check this. So R&B, right? Mm-hmm. You need a voice.
Right,
you can't have just anybody. So it's almost it's a rare breed,
mm-hmm.
like yourself, to have a pen mm-hmm. and a voice.
Right,
it's a rare breed. It's
but what that means is he's not a dope MC.
No,
but he makes good songs.
Okay, so now mm-hmm. let's go here.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, hip hop was always based on your pen, which is why I'm so advocate on don't touch my pen.
Right.
Don't
touch
my pen.
Right,
I'm from old school, like Alpha Male. No, don't touch my pen.
Karina's loving you right now, wherever she is. Karina, don't watch this.
Yeah.
Don't watch this. We had this conversation like a week ago.
Oh, yeah, don't touch my pen, man.
And I feel you. It's back to dance hall, too. It's the same thing. Reggae can get it right. But for me, it's kind of like I categorize. It's like when somebody says to me, who's your favorite singer? I start saying, okay, male or female? Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And then they'll be like, okay, so female. And then I'm like, okay, well, my favorite singer is what my favorite writer is. Because I break it up. Right. But when it comes to a person putting out a song, mm-hmm. I'll give you credit on the song. It's a good song. You delivered it right.
Right.
But I will tell you, well, he's not a writer.
Right.
He's not. But
So he could never be my top 10. Let's just.
I don't think he's in his top 10.
No.
But
no.
If he's being honest.
Yeah.
But the boy makes some good joints.
No, he's got good songs.
But for this album,
I would love to be one of his ghostwriters. Just cut me a check.
I ain't front. I would do it too.
Yeah. I actually want to be a ghostwriter, to be honest.
I want to get on something.
This is just me proving my skills.
Yeah. Be a ghostwriter to somebody. What if you give him a nice joint and he messes it up? Here's the thing about being a ghostwriter, right?
No, he's a good actor. I don't think he can mess it up. Wordplay. Yo.
You ain't right.
Wordplay crazy. I'm playing Scrabble in the oven.
Leave the boy alone. But I haven't heard. I can't say I'm intrigued to go listen to it.
I'm not.
But I'm sure at some point in time I'll hear something from it. You know, but just based on the whole, what I heard, the theory behind it, like you said, the one half is this, it's too calculated.
Yeah.
It's a little bit too calculated. And I think he's in a whack point in his life, especially when
he's on a decline.
So this ain't the one for me.
No.
You know, it's kind of like Lil Wayne. I at a certain point I was done.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know what I mean? Yeah, Kanye too. So I even gave 808 and Heartbreaks a little bit because it was a different. I said, okay, wow. He just went off the deep end and did some stuff that some people might consider whack, but there's some art to it. Everything thereafter, I whether it was good or not, I just never gave it a chance.
Okay.
That's just how I am. You know what I mean? I'm done.
Fair enough.
You know? But it doesn't mean that, because I am the type of person that, and I'm not judging it off of his antics.
Mm-hmm.
I'm judging, because here's the reason why I'm not judging for antics. Mm-hmm. Back in the day, I was working at home.
Mm-hmm.
He dropped Graduation, right?
Mm.
It was right around the time he had some antics with Britney Spears and some antics with Justin Timberlake. And I'm like, I'm done with this fool. He's just too much.
Right.
So I was home one day. I was on my lunch break at home. And lunch break in the evening.
Uh-huh.
And I was watching 106 in Park. And he came on and he performed Big Brother.
Mm.
And I was like, man, why did I turn his TV on, dude? I had to get up and go to Target.
And go buy.
And I bought the album.
Yes.
That's how I am.
Yes.
If you do whatever, and the art is good, I'll separate it too.
On this album, he's got a song called I Thought You'd Never Leave. And that's classic old school Kanye.
He gonna keep that though.
Yeah.
Treat him, he ain't gonna keep that one. One of these days I'll get around to it. Right now, mentally, I'm not in the frame to go listen to Kanye.
No need.
You know?
No need.
If he asked me to write something, though, I'm down. But
Holla at me. That Jay-Z Beyonce, I haven't heard it. I don't know if I'm intrigued to go hear it.
Yeah.
I think a lot of the people that I respect are shifting to feed the wrong people. Right. And it pissed me off because what these guys did beforehand, I respected so much. You've already made your money. To be honest with you, you made, I don't count people's money, so I can't say you made enough money, but you made enough money that you already got a fan base that they're going to buy your stuff regardless.
Right.
So you've gotten to that level that you can stay true to yourself at this point in time and people will still buy it. There's no need for you to still try to feed other people. Like Rick Ross, his sound has now become who he is. He doesn't feed into what everybody else in Miami is doing.
He constantly gives you Rick Ross.
Right.
Yeah.
And now it's like where he wasn't even the Miami sound, he's now the sound of Miami.
Right.
You get what I'm saying?
In a relatively short period of time, too.
Right. And this is
big up Kevin Rogers. Kevin says big shout out to Eddie Nice.
Yeah, that's my brother. That's precise. That's that freaky tie right there.
Oh yeah. That's him right there. Oh nice.
Fam J for life, baby. What up?
Big up. Theo, big up yourself. Thank you so much. Althea, big up. You got a lot of people logging in right now showing love.
Yeah, man. Thank you, man. I do this for y'all, man. Hey, listen, for everybody that's logging in, it's Facebook, Eddie Nice. Instagram's Eddie Nice. Twitter is Eddie_Nice. YouTube, please let me get my subscribers up, man. Eddie Nice, man.
Go support the movement.
Yo, I promise you, I will not let you down.
If for no other reason, if you haven't heard one track, if for no other reason, just to bridge the gap, because the BS people got so many like followers out there. Just this is bridge the gap. All right. Definitely. Now I know you also mentor young artists.
Mm-hmm.
Talk to me about that.
Man, I love it. I think that's the one. That's one of those things that brings life to you.
Right.
You get what I'm saying? It's one of those things that you could never really even get paid to give you that feeling. Mm-hmm. You get what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's a when you take an artist and you watch him grow, and you know that you're a part of that.
Mm-hmm.
It's a super dope feeling, man.
Yeah.
And that feeling that when you watch them in the booth and they're like, oh shit, I got it.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Because they know that, like, they kind of didn't feel like they could ever get there. You know what I mean? And you're like, you're shortening in their learning time frame. You get what I'm saying?
Boot camp.
Oh, man. I tell them all to put your helmet on. Put your helmet on.
I like it.
And it's like, because one of the things is, if I just tell you, no, you didn't do that right.
Right.
You're not going to learn.
Right.
If I say, yo, what the hell was, I'm sorry. If I say, what the hell was that?
Mm-hmm.
It's going to be, you're going to be like, and now you're going to know, never do that again.
Right.
You just cut your learning time frame down. You get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It's kind of that dog.
Camp for
if,
real.
If you tell a dog, yo, don't piss over here.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, okay.
Right.
If you smack him,
he ain't doing it.
He ain't doing it no more.
Right. I feel you.
You get what I'm
I
saying?
I feel you.
So, yeah, I got artist now, Wayne Easy. And he's a dope artist. He learns rather quickly.
Right.
You know, it's funny. He questions. When he does question, he doesn't really question a lot. When he does question, you know, you could tell he's like, I have to say this. He probably won't like this, but I think he was testing me one time.
Yeah.
So he brought one of his trap beats, and he was like, oh, I want you to feature on this. Now you know that this is not my lane, but when I tell you I'm a musician, I can write on anything.
Right.
And I'm still gonna keep my lyrics. Don't confuse it.
Right.
I'm not going to dumb it down. I don't know how to do that.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
So he brought me the song. No problem. Sent it back to him the same night. He was like, yo, you had that ready? Nah.
Right.
What? By the way, that's my rough draft. What do you mean? Like, you going to rewrite it? I always rewrite my stuff, man.
Right.
This is my brand. Like, this is what I want people to listen to.
Right.
You get what I'm saying?
Right.
And in that verse, he doesn't like it because I always bring it up. In that verse, and that song will come out sooner or later.
That's his project though.
It's our that one's on our group project.
Mm, okay.
Okay. So that one it says I recite then rewrite so that you rewind.
Wow.
Right? Wow. Now, what did I tell you?
Right,
every time
right,
you
right.
hear something on my, mm. like, you're going to hear a different punchline in a song like that you never heard. Like,
Right.
And that's why.
That's real, though.
Yeah. So that's why I don't do that one run through. Like, you want to copy Jay-Z? Go ahead, do that.
Right.
Do that. But this is how I feel I make my music timeless. Whereas I hear songs that I did a long time ago, and I'm like, oh, shit, that was dope. I never got time to fall in love with that song.
Right.
But I recite, then rewrite just so you rewind.
Yeah, and that I had to rewind a couple of these, but and that's how you make timeless music, though.
Yeah,
you know what I mean.
That is
when you take yourself outside of that and start writing for not you, because truth be told, you're not the one going out there consuming your own stuff. A lot of times, I know how I am. Sometimes I don't. If you hear me listening to my music,
mm-hmm.
it's because I got a show coming up and I don't know the words. You know what I'm saying?
You know what that means? Let me tell you what that is.
Mm-hmm.
For everyone who's listening,
mm-hmm.
what he just said is a perfect example of what a true artist is, because you're writing so much, like you're just sitting there writing, that you don't get to really fall in love with your song like everybody else does. And
yeah.
So I gotta
people
break.
Ask me for songs that I, because the other thing is this, you got a certain amount of songs on it, you don't always perform all of them,
right?
But people come out, I've had people come out and ask me for songs,
mm-hmm.
I'm not even gonna lie, and I will tell them that I'm gonna do it and try to run the set out, get about it, you know what I mean? Because I know we rehearse that. I remember, I'm working with a live band here.
Right.
It's not
right.
like the track is there, you know what I'm saying? So I didn't rehearse none of this or whatever, and I try to get out of it, but it is true.
Yeah.
It's like you have that material and you have it down and you have such good stuff, but you're moving on to the next one that you don't
get to fall in love with it.
Nah.
Yeah.
And somebody else does.
Yeah.
But that's because you spend so much time making sure.
Everything's perfect. Because I gotta jump into the story.
Mm-hmm.
Volume 1. This is the original. This is court cases are coming on heavy. This is I'm putting songs together. There's no real rhyme or reason to me doing it. It's just me having fun in the studio. I built the studio in my house simply because I have a son and I can't go out to a studio.
Right.
So I'm doing these songs. And boy comes over and he's like, "Yo, what are you doing with these songs?" I'm like, "I don't know, man. I'm just doing the songs." He's like, "Yo, you should make a mixtape." Okay, long story short, I make a mixtape. Finally pass it out everywhere. Mm-hmm. Everywhere. So my son's playing football. I'm on the practice field every day. Fathers, present fathers.
Love it.
So while I'm on the field, I literally walk around the whole field and pass out a CD to everybody, to anybody.
Right.
Okay. So fast forward, the season is ending, and now they're at the playoffs or championships or one of those games. And again, I'm from Brooklyn. We move different.
Right.
We talk different.
Right.
And there's a straight up Miami dude. I remember his brother's name. I really don't remember his name. But dude looks like he been through it. Kind of the dude, like, you really don't want to, like, talk to you. You know what I mean? So he's walking towards me. Mm-hmm. And I'm RoboCop in the situation, I promise you. I'm just scanning through it. I'm like, "Yo, what is this?" Like, mm-hmm. I'm trying to read it. I'm trying to check your temperature, buddy.
Right,
like,
right.
It don't look right. You beelining straight to me, man. Like, this don't look right.
Right.
He's like, "Yo, nice. This nigga know my name."
Right.
"What up?" Yo, let me introduce you to my wife. Oh, man.
Like, is this something that I'm...
Yeah. Yeah. I'm glad I had to say that. You know what I mean? I'm like, "Yo, what the hell is this?
Did I get myself into something right now?
What the hell is
this? She ain't tell me."
So, it's daylight, and we're on a football field. There's mad people here. I'm still scanning, checking the temperature everywhere.
Right.
Like, somebody going to jump out the bushes or something. So, I get over there, and this dude's like, "Baby, this the guy I'm talking about. Yo, that fucking album is sick. Yo." And
he had the mixtape.
Yo. Yo. Yo, I've never froze up ever before like that in my life. Like, he was complimenting me so much, I didn't know what to do with my face. I didn't know.
Right, right.
And he was just like, "Yo, this he's the realest artist. He is just straight lyrics. Everything is just, oh my God, he's so dope." And it was track two. It's track two. It was an AZ song,
right,
that I redid, and he started singing it, and he sang it better than I ever sang. I promise you, word for word, he had the flow down pack.
Right,
he was just going in, and now a crowd builds.
Right,
and everybody's like, "Yo, that shit is dope." He's like, "That's not me. That's him." And I still don't know what to do with my
right,
face.
Right.
If I had died at that moment, I still would have been a happy man.
Wow. Because
I touched, like...
You touched so much.
You know what the thing is going on in your head? Like, yo.
You don't know where it's going.
Right. And this dude, I'm going to live forever through this dude, because he's going to keep remembering this song. Because he took the time to memorize these words.
Right.
He's going to think about it again.
They can't imagine if it was garbage. He would have come up and be like, "Yo, babe."
Nah. I'd have been dodging a Frisbee. A CD Frisbee would have been coming towards my head. Like, "Oh, what the hell?"
And that's why. Do it right.
Yeah.
Or don't do it at all.
From jump, man.
And you mentioned the track. You don't know what's going to, you know, what's going to touch somebody. Funny enough, you mentioned that. Is the circumstances are always pretty similar. I always tell people, nothing you go through is unique to you. I remember back in the day when before the band, when we were working tracks, right? Mm-hmm. We went down to this place called Sankofa. It was a South African joint that they had in South Beach, and there were live music and stuff.
Okay.
So we went down there, and I'm performing. It's me, it's Jayut, it's Jay Will. I'm singing. Jay Will sings too, but he was DJing, just the balance.
Right.
And then Jayut was the chanter, you know what I mean? The energy money guy. So we kind of traded off, and boom, people loving it.
Right.
At the end of my show, I got a song called Sail Away. It's the slowest, mellowest, you know what I mean? Sail Away. Picture the words. Mm-hmm. Sail Away. Mm-hmm. At the end of the show, these two dudes is coming up to me. Same kind of vibe. Like, you don't know what's going on with these two dudes.
Right.
Pants foot all rolled up, dreads down. These don't look like Rasta. These look like dread. You know what I mean?
Same thing. He had the doo-doo dreads.
Yeah.
So, I'm not... In New York, we don't do the doo-doo dreads.
Right.
So,
right.
That's already a temperature change. Like...
Because that ain't Rasta. That's...
Yeah.
We're coming up to, you know what I mean?
Yeah, that's Miami street shit.
I'm like, what's up? Are we on South Beach?
Yeah, yeah.
So, dudes came up to me and they were like... they still ain't smiling through all this.
Yeah,
they're like,
yeah.
yo, let me get, because we're selling CDs. Let me get one of them CDs. And I'm like, which one do you want? He's like, the one with the sale. I'm like, what? Which one? Because I didn't know what, you know what I mean? Yeah. And he's like, the one that go, sale. You know what I'm
saying? He's still got to keep in thug mode.
in thug mode. I'm no smiles, no nothing. And in the back of my mind, I'm like, yo, after all the hard hitting stuff you heard, you come over here telling me you want to sail away?
Yeah.
And those are the first two CDs I sold. Mm. Not handed out, given away.
Right.
Sold. Yeah, I even tried to give it to the dude. And he was like, nah. Gave me my $5 for each one.
Yeah.
And boom, boom, and they walked off. That was the most moved I was as an artist ever. So I know exactly what you're talking about.
And that feeling says, nah, I can't stop this.
Heck no.
I can't stop this.
Nah. Yes.
I see my purpose.
You done did it. Yeah. You done did it. I love it. Now, with this new lease on life, this new lease on music, this new appreciation for it all,
mm-hmm.
I know life support's coming up,
mm-hmm.
but that ain't just it. What else is on the horizon?
We got life support, and we got Silent Whispers.
Mm-hmm.
We got the We album, which is Wayne Easy, Eddie Nice, so W.E.
Okay.
And I'm pretty much executive producing Wayne Easy's album anyway. So that's dope.
Big up Wayne Easy. Send me some of his joint. Let me check him out. The thing
is,
on Green Gate they play the dopest stuff.
Okay.
So pretty much I'll send it over to them too.
Yeah.
And they'll show love.
Of course.
They show love. Now, bro, I can't tell you.
And then I got to do. Mm-hmm. I stopped the Incredible series. I got to volume 3. I'm stopping that. And of course,
No more Incredible.
I don't want to do no more Incredible. Incredible instead of the IN, it was EN for Eddie Nice. Mm-hmm. So Incredible.
Mm-hmm.
This one's gonna be Unstoppable with the EN again. So we're gonna start the Unstoppable series.
I got you.
And I think Redbone will be on the Unstoppable. Redbone's not gonna be on life support. Redbone's gonna be on the
Unstoppable.
Unstoppable.
I can see that.
Yeah.
I can see.
Because I wanted to still follow the theme of the Incredible kind. But I need to, you know, you gotta close the chapter on that.
I got it. Who out there needs to get shouted out right now? From production to musicianship to just fans showing love to artists? Who?
Ooh, man, I hate this part, man. My memory's not that good. Shout out to Besice. He's always rocking with me. Shout out to the whole Street Dreams fam. Shout out to ATM. Shout out to Fam J for Life. Shout out to all the producers, PJ Pressure, Q, Eric A, Lingo, all the features.
Too much to mention.
Yo, all the people that really support me, like really listen, all the people that have subscribed, all the people that just follow me and just been loyal fans. Cause one thing I do hear is that people say, yo, your fan is like, they're loyal fans.
I mean, it's good music. It's easy to vacillate when you're getting BS on Monday and you're getting good stuff on Tuesday. You know what I'm saying? But if it's coming, it's quality. And right. Again, don't get me wrong. No matter who it is, right. You're gonna love this more than you love that.
Right.
But it's still on point. Yeah. You know what I mean? Because certain things resonate more than other things.
Right.
Certain
right.
situations you're going through, you know, you can relate to. But when you're getting good stuff, man, I feel excited about it. You know what I mean? Because when I get good stuff, that's when it comes to music. A lot of people get excited about a whole bunch of stuff. My excitement comes from music. You know what I mean?
Listen. I just thought about this. You're gonna love a song called "Fake Niggas." You're gonna love it.
Who's the feature? Is it Agent R?
No. The first, I'm actually gonna do two versions of that.
Mm-hmm.
All off rip. I'm letting you know. I'm doing two versions. The first one is all me.
Right.
And it touches up on so much, and the wordplay on that is crazy.
What's that on? Which project is that on?
That's gonna be on Life Support.
Oh, okay.
That's on Life Support.
When is Life Support coming out?
We're looking at September.
September.
Yeah. Okay. So we're not that far.
And it's gonna be everywhere.
It's gonna be everywhere.
All right.
And I'm really trying to shoot a video for almost every one of them.
Wow.
Because I'm having fun now.
Right.
That's another thing. I think during a cycle you lose the fact of having fun.
Right.
It just becomes work.
Work.
Yeah. And so I'm having fun.
Yeah.
I'm having fun.
I like it.
Yeah.
I'm digging it. Ladies and gentlemen, listen. And now, listen. So many people that are tuning in right now. There are a lot of people tuning in at No 89. There's a lot of people that are hearing about you for the first time.
Right.
I can tell you this. From the music to life stories to what you're doing to just the jewels to the knowledge, a lot of people have been I've benefited a lot.
Right.
Some people haven't seen it yet. It's online, so they're going to go look it up. A lot of people are going to be motivated by that. So
please do. And let me say this, mm-hmm. and every one of my fans knows this. If you hit me up and you ask me a question or you want to have a dialogue or you think about anything, I actually reach back and I talk because I don't know what you want.
Right.
You know what I mean? And I might not necessarily be in that lane to do that, but I still want to hear your views.
Right.
You get what I'm saying? So
that's consumer research right there.
Yeah. I always accept the feedback. I'm not that dude that mm-hmm. no, well, you know what? Forget you.
Right.
Nah. I want to hear what you got to say. I do. So I will always respond back. I love it. I honestly love it. And that tells me that you're listening.
Yeah. Interactive, ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah.
You want it. Not everybody's going to do it.
Yeah. I'm old school, man. I'm built for this.
And rightfully so, because again, you're going to get the fan base is going to be based on the material you're putting out. So if you're putting out intelligent material, it's highly likely that the fans are going to be intelligent fans. So you can have that conversation. You're putting out BS. You're going to have some BS people hollering at you, having some BS conversation. So this will definitely, I mean, it makes your life easier in terms of, you know, with regard to being able to respond to these people.
Of course. Good morning, world.
Appreciate you, man. On behalf of all the homegrown listeners and myself, I want to personally thank you, man, for sharing your time. Nah, man.
Yo, listen. Honestly speaking, you know you're my brother. Like, I don't have to tell you that.
Trust me.
But you know that already, man. We go way back. And man, anytime you need me for a feature, you already know.
Jayut, get at me like right now. You know what I mean?
But it's always love with you, man. Real talk, appreciate man. Real talk.
I'm gonna come back when life support's out.
Can we come back for like almost every single?
You can come back for whatever.
All right.
You know what I mean?
All right.
Come back any Tuesday evening right here. We'll drop it.
Let's do that.
You know what I mean? The Green Gate family love it out there, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you. Now, again, you might have dropped it before. I want you to drop it again. Drop some social media info for the masses that want to get in contact.
Yes. Facebook, Eddie Nice. Instagram, Eddie Nice. Twitter, Eddie_Nice. YouTube, the most important, Eddie Nice. It's really, really simple, guys. Come on, man. I'm not even charging you for this stuff. I'm giving you real raw things that would be on people's albums. Okay, those are like my freestyles. Those are like, you know what I mean, the things that I'm not even. Yeah. So when Silent Whispers come, that's a whole different world. But anyway, so yeah, man. These are things that other people would live off of, and I'm giving it to you for free because this is just practice for me.
Wow.
Like when I go intense, I go intense.
Right.
You know what
right.
I mean. So when you just got that that taking in blood, come on, man. That's me in my slumber right there, man.
I love it.
You know what I mean? I love it. It was fun.
It's like them Dolphins practice games that they charge you a bag of money for. You know?
I can't co-sign that one. But yeah, no. So definitely, man. Please subscribe and holler at me, man. I'm really a humble dude. Don't mind the cockiness. Is the cockiness that you have to have when you're doing music.
That confidence is necessary.
Right.
Necessary.
Yes.
So to do anything and do it well.
Yes.
People talk about ego. Everybody that's good at what they do have to have one. You're just not driven by it and controlled by it.
Yeah, that's it.
But it's a part of the package.
Yeah. I'm Mayweather in the booth.
I love it. Anyways, ladies and gentlemen, there you have it. Thank you so much for tuning in. It has indeed been a pleasure. Please be sure to subscribe to the podcast Homegrown with G Cole, available now on iTunes, Google Play, Stitcher, TuneIn, Spotify, iHeartRadio, all your podcast platforms. Also, please check out our website, homegrownwithgcole.com, for all things homegrown and to listen. Remember, be safe, be kind, and be good to each other. My name is G Cole. This is Eddie Nice, and this is Homegrown.
Nakikinika sa musika, Homegrown with G Cole.
Estás escuchando Homegrown con G Cole.
您现在正在收听的是 Homegrown with G Cole.
You're listening to Homegrown with G Cole.
Thank you so much for tuning in. I hope you enjoyed that one as much as I did. Please click on the subscribe button below. Subscribe to this YouTube channel, and I'll keep you posted when new material is available. Keep it moving, keep it grooving. It is Homegrown.